l'arte islamico, perciò abbiamo la fortuna, credo, vedremo dopo, no? Di avere qui al professor Mattia Guidetti, che come vedete ha un cognome molto italiano, è italiano, lui è nato e è cresciuto a Milano, ma subito l'università è andata a seguirla a Venezia, dove anni fa Venezia, Roma e Napoli erano le uniche università in Italia dove si potevano seguire o dove si poteva seguire la laurea in orientalistica, e cioè cultura, arte, archeologia, letteratura, lingua orientale. Dopo ha avuto un'amplissima carriera internazionale, andando in Inghilterra e adesso in altri posti, e adesso lui è ricercatore nell'Università di Vienna, Kunsthistorisches Akademie, o come funziona lì?
Il Dipartimento di Storia dell'Arte, l'Istituto di Storia dell'Arte, anzi, dell'Università di Vienna.
Dell'Università, quindi molto prestigioso, e io l'ho conosciuto, diciamo, scientificamente, leggendo un suo libro che è uscito, penso, l'anno scorso, molto interessante, sulla trasformazione o il cambiamento tra le chiese e le moschee, che è uno dei temi, la transizione, così come noi studiamo la transizione del mondo romano al mondo tardo antico alto medievale, anche un tema fondamentale per il nostro periodo è la transizione in alcune aree specifiche tra mondo alto medievale, tardo antico e mondo islamico. Un po' di questo ce ne ha parlato il nostro altro ospite di questi giorni, Alberto Leon. Oggi vedremo specificamente quello più, penso, basato nella parte orientale dell'impero. Questo libro, io a volte faccio queste cose, quando l'ho letto ho detto: ma che bello che è questo libro, le ho scritto e gliel'ho detto, no, io sono famosa, eccetera, ho detto le farà piacere sentirlo, e senza essere comunque una specialista in questo tema, e lui subito mi ha risposto: grazie, hai visto bene, perché ho appena vinto un premio molto importante proprio per questo libro. E detto questo, ho detto: devi assolutamente venire a Padova a collaborare un po' con noi, e oggi ci farà questa lezione che è un po' basata anche su questo libro, sulle sue ricerche, poiché sapete che l'Università di Padova presta molto ed è molto interessata anche per la vostra propria formazione nella internazionalità. Lui parla perfettamente l'inglese, quindi gliela faremo fare, visto che è uno studioso internazionale e che voi me lo avete chiesto, vogliamo le lezioni in inglese, quindi la faremo in inglese molto piano, perché voi possiate seguire, e se ci sono qualche problema, dubbi, eccetera, evidentemente italiano, quindi ve la può anche tradurre. Senz'altro chiederemo anche, e come glielo chiedo adesso per prima volta davanti a voi, gli chiederemo se ci passa il PowerPoint per poterlo mettere in internet, e che così potete seguire meglio, e il nostro collaboratore Andrea super gentilmente sta anche filmando, quindi metteremo anche il video su YouTube, quindi di più non si può fare. Io senz'altro darei la parola a lui, ringraziandolo per essere venuto a fare questa lezione per voi. Credo che è una lezione che comunque combina molto arte, storia, archeologia, quindi anche ideale per il nostro corso, che è molto misto, molto bello. Grazie.
Bene, grazie Alexandra. Okay, so I use English, so I will present in English, I will read the text, I will try to read it carefully, slowly, but I mean, any question you might have, just raise your hand, any doubt, any miscomprehension of what I'm talking about, or the quotations I'm gonna cite during the presentation, just raise your hand and I stop and we try to make it clear, either in English again or in Italian, of course. I mean, so it's a pleasure, of course, to be invited here in Padova. It's also a pleasure to have the opportunity to give my presentation after the presentations by Professor Alberto Leon, who, as far as I understood, introduced you to some of the main themes related to the appearance or rise of Islam in the Mediterranean area, with a focus on the Iberian Peninsula, of course, because this is what his focus. Today, however, we are going to move from Iberia, so from the Western Mediterranean, to the Eastern Mediterranean, to the Syrian region. And with Syria, of course, here I mean the Greater Syria, so the historic Syria, which means an area today covered by, of course, Syria, Lebanon, southeastern Turkey, Jordan, Palestine, and Israel. And basically my research, well, I come from Islamic studies, or let's say Islamic art and archaeology. In Vienna, I'm working in an institute for art history within the chair of Islamic art. So I'm an Islamicist. But since the very beginning of my studies, I've been interested, also thanks to my PhD supervisor, to the transition between late antiquity and early Islam. A very important point of history. And my research, after a while, after my PhD, moved to this specific topic of what happened to late antique churches when early Muslims decided to build their own mosques. This is basically the main research question at the base of my, or the beginning of my research. What did happen to them? Were they converted into mosques? Were they used by Muslims? Were they not used? What happened to them? And at the same time, of course, from an Islamic perspective, so the point, I mean, the research question is, as new masters of a Christian land, because Syria in the 7th century was mostly a Christian land, so what should I do with all these monumental buildings, monumental churches that are basically everywhere in the landscape? So what is my, what kind of relationship I can create with this kind of legacy? Should I destroy it? Should I use it? Should I just try to challenge them, etc.? Okay, so the title of the book, just mentioned, is not Churches and Mosques in Early Medieval Syria, which is a sort of short title, but the title of the book is In the Shadow of the Church, the Building of Mosques in Early Medieval Syria. This is the book. And as I said, my research interest in the transition between late antiquity and the early medieval period, please notice that within, let's say, Islamic studies, early medieval period is very often defined as early Islamic period. So very often early Islam is what here I define early medieval. So more or less the period between the conquest, which is the 7th century more or less, up to, well, this is a question mark, perhaps the 10th century, 11th century, so the first centuries of Islamic domination in the Mediterranean area. So, and to start basically today presentation, I would like to discuss this drawing, which is taken from one of Sauvage's works, and that was published in the year 1934. This scheme is important per se, as it relates to the development of classical roads in a Syrian city that is called Laodicea. But it also became a sort of icon, as it has been used in several scholarly discussions and publications devoted to the end of the classical city. What this scheme here offers is an effort to trace the changes brought by the development of classical cities in the post-classical period by tracing the transformation of a public road. Such a scheme was produced with regard to Laodicea, in Arabic Latakia, a city today located on the Syrian seaside, so north of Lebanon. As you see here, the street visually and literally connects the Roman period to the medieval period without any further segmentation. So the Roman period would be on the left hand side, and the medieval period on the right hand side.
Vi ricordate la nostra parte, professor Leo, come si trasforma una strada da romano a poi il periodo?
As much as you proceed towards the Middle Ages, the road becomes encroached and packed with building structures that hide the original surface and deprive the road of its original functionality. This is clear. What is shown here is the well-known phenomenon of the privatization and encroachment of the public space that was considered one of the features of the demise of the classical city. And this is a phenomenon that has been revealed by archaeology. Now, the problem here, and this is why I'm showing to you this image here today, is to understand where we should put the Islamic conquest, chronologically, within this road. Despite Sauvager did not insert any indication on the drawing itself, the text of the article was clear in identifying the beginning of the Islamic rule with a sort of change and with an acceleration in the disappearance of public space in cities inherited by Islam from antiquity. So it's according to Sauvager and according to the, let's say, early 20th century scholarship, the roads were a signal, a sort of ringing bell, of an overall approach to the maintenance of cities and to changes in the administration of the urban fabric as well as in its social organization. While the importance of studying roads to get a larger picture of the changes a society of the changes of society that proceeded in scholarship, more recent excavations have identified in late antiquity, and more precisely for the area, the process of Christianization of the area, as a major turning point in the process of disintegration of the classical layout of cities. Such an interpretation can even be more refined, as it seems that whenever an imperial agent or patron was at work, a revitalization of the hippodamic classical layout was recovered again. This is true in both the Byzantine period, well, I can mention the city of Zalabeia on a Euphrates, in which this classical layout was still basically recovered in the 6th century. But also, very interestingly, is also the case of the early Islamic period, when under the Umayyad rule, what seems to emerge in several Palatine city units is an explicit effort to preserve and reinforce the idea of the classical city. So basically, what I want to say with these two first slides is that it's not possible, let's say, to identify with Islamic conquest the demise of the classical layout of cities. But rather, this is a process which belongs more largely to the late antique period, so including the Christianization of the society during late antiquity, and also, of course, the early Islamic period. But however, we should keep in mind that at the same time, whenever the patron of a city, or whenever we are talking about an imperial foundation, the classical layout was still used, both in late antiquity and in early medieval or early Islamic period. So this city here, on the left-hand side, voila, here, is Anjar, is in today Lebanon. It's an Umayyad city. And as you can see, I mean, the layout of the city with the tetrapylon at the center of the two main roads is following, clearly, a classical model. So on the one hand, we have this sort of disintegration of the classical layout of the city, but at the same time, in some cases, which very often are related to the presence of power, of authority, the classical layout is still considered to be the model to be used, even up to after the conquest. Another point, however, why I'm discussing all this aspect of the transformation of cities during late antiquity and the early medieval period is that this discussion has been central in several studies. Scholars have studied economic and productive aspects. Means of transportation are very important. Of course, once the roads are not longer available, Chariots, for instance, can no longer be used. And so another kind of mean of transportation should be used. And for instance, camels or horses or donkeys are used instead of chariots, for instance, in these roads. So this is also a sort of consequence of this transformation. Of course, patronage and public building activities were all features under investigation. As the focus of scholars was largely on notions such as economic decline and trade continuity or discontinuity, what remained little studied was the transformation of religious architecture during these centuries. As the conversion of, as Alexander mentioned at the beginning of this conference, of pagan temples into churches, so from classical antiquity to the Christian period, and more generally, the Christianization of late antique society was a topic by itself and very well rooted in old-time disciplines like Christian archaeology and late antique studies more recently. What was left behind a little bit, largely, I would say, understudied, is the conversion of churches into mosques or, more broadly, the Islamization of the landscape after the 7th century. And indeed, this specific gap in the literature, in the scholar production, is also due to a sort of very rigid watershed, so a rigid kind of division, between disciplines, such as late antique studies and Islamic studies, Oriental studies, kind of another branch. Even different departments are following these two, despite the fact they are very close. They are basically studied by different scholars, pertaining or belonging to different departments. At least in Europe or in some of the European countries. So the central question I've started my research was largely not addressed by scholarship. And as I told you at the beginning, is what did happen to Christian churches after the 7th century? And how did churches interact with mosques? Now, the work by Piccirillo, and you see here the cover of one of his books, perhaps the most important among his books, was also very influential. And why? Because he discovered floor mosaics dated to the 8th century. So he discovered Christian floor mosaics dated to the 8th century, so dated after the Islamic conquest, in the area of today Jordan and Palestine. And this discovery, they also changed traditional paradigms and related researches on Christian Greek inscriptions, for instance. The work by Di Segni, an Israeli scholar, for instance, refined the continuity of Christian life into Muslim society by redating Greek inscription and therefore Christian building also after the Islamic conquest. So slowly the presence of the Christian presence after the Islamic conquest became more noticeable, more clear. So Christians were not only there, but were also building new churches, decorating new churches, etc. So the point is, if Christian churches were still active and powerful entities in the early Islamic cities, what was then their impact on the contemporary development of early mosques? Now, Piccirillo, however, I mean, he was a very interesting scholar, was a Franciscan priest, but he was only interested in finding these mosaics, dating them, of course, but his focus were mainly basically the Christian buildings, the Christian floor mosaics, and he was not paying too much attention to the context in which these mosaics were basically done. And this is because, as I told you, there was this kind of rigid watershed. I mean, if you come from late antiquity, you should stop either with Islamic conquest or you should stop with the Christian material. Instead, if you come from the Islamic studies, well, you can study the early Islamic period, the early Islamic mosques, the early Islamic material, but you should stop yourself and not deal with the Christian material or with the late antique kind of heritage. So, and Piccirillo was still belonging to this kind of binary division in our field, or in this field that I'm now describing.
Questa è una cosa che ho provato io durante il corso a farvi capire. La divisione rigida di materie, storia dell'arte, archeologia, storia, o allo stesso tempo la divisione rigida di periodi, noi non capiremo mai la vita antico senza comprendere bene il mondo romano. E allo stesso tempo gli islamisti, fino a pochissimo tempo fa, fino a questi due studiosi, praticamente attribuivano al mondo islamico delle caratteristiche, alle moschee, all'umanistica, eccetera, delle cose che in realtà voi stessi oggi, dopo aver fatto le cinque lezioni sulla città, vedete che sono anche anteriori. Quindi questo è un problema del sistema di ricerca universitaria, una troppa compartimentazione di saperi e una troppa specializzazione di quello che facciamo. Noi dovremmo essere studiosi globali, non di tutto, però avere una conoscenza più diacronica e più evolutiva dei fenomeni, perché altrimenti restiamo sempre alla superficie.
Yeah, this is perfect. I mean, how can you, for instance, study the city of Anjar on the left hand side of the slide if you are not well trained in late classical, late antique studies? And from an Islamic point of view, you can make almost nothing out of it, apart of course the presence of the mosque. But I mean, okay, so now I would like now to enter really the subject of my work with the plan of late antique, so pre-Islamic, Christian, Aleppo. Taken again from an article by another French scholar, Ecocar, who was working within the Sauvage kind of sphere of influence. So under Sauvage influential charisma and work. Sauvage is the scholar who produced the drawing of the road of Latakia, or Laodicea. Now, we are going to focus later on this site here, in which clearly you can see a church and another, well, some of the roads around basically the church. Now, however, before getting to the site, and here you see an aerial view of Aleppo, made in the 50s. This was one of the most beautiful legacy of the French scholarship, is this documentation of Syrian cities. Of course, you know Aleppo has been largely destroyed by the current war in Syria. I mean, more specifically, this site here, which is the site here, in which there is also the mosque of Aleppo, was largely destroyed together with the souk in the past few years. And this is, of course, is very sad per se, in the sense that for the local population, but it's also very sad for our scholarship. I mean, for a better understanding of the processes, of the historical processes. Okay. So now I would like to emphasize three points related to the late antique legacy Muslims encountered, Muslims got, once they conquered Syria. So what was the situation there once Muslims from Arabia, Arab Muslims, moved and conquered Byzantine Syria? So the first point is the centrality of the main Christian sanctuary within the cities. Sometimes the result of the development of the area of the temple, so sometimes the church was built over the temple, or in other cases built at the crossroads of important avenues of the cities, great churches, so the most important churches, were very often located in pivotal parts of cities, so in the central area, in the core areas of cities. This is something later on highlighted also by a Muslim scholar, a geographer of the 10th century, Al-Muqaddasi, who wrote that he was astonished by the fact that so many religions decide to build their own main place of worship in the center of cities. So this is the first point. The second point is the architectural nature of such buildings, so of the great churches. By looking at various material and textual evidence, it is clear how ecclesiastical structures were not consisting of only one simple basilica, so it's not only one church, one building, but were large compounds, and I think you know better than I mean, all this reality, large compounds inserted into the urban fabric. Courtyards, water facilities, residential structures, chapels, baptisteries, and one or more basilica structures for the congregational worship created a sort of island within the city. And this is an extremely important point in order to understand how Muslims appropriated Christian properties in the conquered cities in the Middle East or in Syria, let's say, to be more precise. So the church, very often, we're going to see later, Arabic sources say, well, the Muslims took this church, using a word in Arabic which is kanisa, church. So but what is the church? The church is a complex of buildings, right? It's a sort of a compound. This is a very important point. And here you see three different examples, I mean, just to give you an idea. But again, coming from more than I, from late antique studies, you know this kind of landscape better than I do. Okay. So the third, and there is a long quotation, and I'm going to explain you why, is the balance among different Christian communities. So you know that the Christian world, conquered by Islam, was not a kind of monolith, but was consisted of different Christian communities. One of them was related and dependent on Byzantium, but other communities, especially the Monophysite communities, were basically sometimes in conflict with the Chalcedonian Byzantine related communities. So the Christian landscape inherited by Islam was a complex Christian landscape. Not only that, it's important. This passage, so let's try to read this passage. I can't read here on my slide because it's too small. I can read it here. So now, who is talking, who is writing this text, is a Monophysite person, Monophysite bishop. So he's basically on the Monophysite side. And he says, the cathedral churches which had been unjustly confiscated from our people by Heraclius, so the Byzantine emperor, and given to his the Chalcedonians, have continued to languish in their possession until the present day. For at the time when they were conquered and made subjects of the Arabs, the cities agreed to terms of surrender, under which each confession had assigned to it those temples, those churches, which were found in its possession. This is a very important point. In this way, the Orthodox from his point of view, so the Monophysite, so my community, was robbed of the great church of Edessa, and that of Han, and this process continued throughout the West as far as Jerusalem. So this is a very important passage. It says two important things. One, that before the Islamic conquest, there was the Persian conquest, and after the Persian conquest, the reconquest by Byzantium, carried out by Heraclius. And when Heraclius took it back, the Syrian area, to the empire, he decided the main churches to be given to the Chalcedonians, to the Christian community related to Byzantium, of course. whereas the other communities were left other churches. So this is a very important first point. The second point is that he is basically blaming Heraclius more than the Arabs. He's blaming Heraclius because he's saying, well, these churches, still in my own days, are languishing in the hands of this Christian community. Hmm? Which means that still in the early medieval period, Dionysius is writing in the 9th century, so after the Islamic conquest, he's saying, well, even nowadays, these churches are in the hands, are used, are possessed by this Christian community. Hmm? And this is unjust, this is wrong, but this is because of Heraclius, not because of Muslims. Huh? The Muslims just basically frozen, they froze the situation that they encounter when they conquer these cities. Okay? So this was the third point. Now, the next step is to flip some of the pages of the same article I mentioned you before by Ecocard, this French scholar. So you take the same article and you turn the pages and you arrive to this plan. And this plan is showing the situation of the site with the full Islamization of the same site. Okay? So you remember the plan before, yeah? In which there was a church and an area beside the church. Well, the next plan is showing the building A, which is a medieval madrasa, which clearly is replacing the church we show in the other plan, and then the building B, which is the mosque of Aleppo. Okay? So you have the late antique phase of the city and the medieval, so the late antique Christian phase of the city and the medieval Islamic phase of the city. So the problem, however, is that this situation started only when the building A was converted from Christian use to a Muslim use. And the date of this conversion is 1124, so the 12th century. Okay? So the problem we face is what happened in between. Late antiquity, the church, medieval period, this Islamic medieval building. So 6th century, let's say, 12th century. So what happened in between? Okay. Because of course, if you take a medieval Islamic perspective, this plan is perfectly clear. It makes sense. It's coherent. If you travel Syria, unfortunately and sadly, this is not possible today, nowadays, but if you travel Syria or southeastern Turkey and you visit the main cities, well, in the center of cities, what you are going to find are mosques. So here I show you two examples, which I find very also aesthetically nice. And one is the Mosque of Marat al-Numan, a city located south of Aleppo, close to Aleppo. And on the right-hand side, you have an image of the Mosque of Diyarbakir, which is in southern eastern Turkey. Well, this mosque here dates to the 11th century. This mosque dates to the 12th century. So you see that starting with the 11th, 12th century, the center of each Syrian city was Islamized. The process of Islamization was completed, so to speak. And these new buildings were dominating the landscape. So this plan here, it's showing on the ground this situation here. Okay? So my research question, and my point also today, is what happened in the early medieval period, so before these mosques were built, before this building A was built, what happened? So now, how scholars, the next step basically would be, how scholars explain before myself, before my generation of scholars, this situation, this period? Now, the most influential scholar in this regard is Caswell. So an English scholar who was based in Egypt and who wrote a very influential book, an enormous book. I mean, the dimension of the book is and the weight of the book is really monumental. And it's called Early Muslim Architecture, first edition 32, So again, contemporary to Sauvage, reprinted in 69, short version published in 89, I think, but still very influential. So, and he says on this period, in these early days, so the early days of Islam in Syria, Muslims, when they conquered a town in Syria, usually took one of the churches and used it as a mosque, or merely divided one of the churches if the town had surrendered without resistance. Okay? So that's the common explanation for the Islamic conquest of this Christian territory. So he offers two possibilities in order to make sense of the use of churches by early Muslims. The first is the direct conversion of a church into a mosque. The second is instead the usage of one portion of the church as a mosque. And Creswell here connects these two different modalities with the two different modalities of conquest. So the second choice would be connected to the surrender of the city without resistance. While the first, we assume, would be the direct consequence of a military conquest of a given city. So on the one hand, you have the Muslim army arriving at the gate of the city, and after a battle conquering the city, well, in this case, once the city was conquered, the Christian church was requisitioned, so was taken by Muslims, and used as a mosque, according to Creswell, of course. This is the first possibility, this is the first option. The second option is, well, before the battle, the bishop very often negotiated, sort of surrendered, peaceful surrendered. Okay, we're going to acknowledge the Muslims as the new masters of the city. We're going to pay you taxes. We're going to pay you something. We're going to be on your side. But in exchange, you grant us our properties, including the churches. And the Muslims negotiated, yes, it's okay, but one portion of the church should be used by us, for our mosques. Okay.
Ricordate, questa è la visione tradizionale, non vuol dire che questo sia vero, ma poco tempo fa si pensava che quello che fanno gli islamici è, se la gente è buona, le pattuisce col vescovo e gli lasciano la chiesa principale, sicuramente. Se la gente è cattiva, gliela
prendiamo.
No, però è tradizionale. Ricordatevi di differenziare quello che è la ricerca attuale dalla ricerca tradizionale.
Sì. Well, yeah, exactly. And I must add that Creswell was working in the 30s of the 20th century. So many later archaeological discoveries and excavations were, of course, unknown to him because he lived before the discovery. So, I mean, he had this view also based on the material he had. Now, I will skip this because it complicates a bit the picture, and I think it's misleading. So, now it's, let's see, because it's true that we have a few cases, only few, at least for now, in which it's clear, or almost clear, that Muslims made use of a church as a mosque. So they converted the church into a mosque. And now, let's see what are these buildings. The first one is the church you see here in this slide. And this was unknown to Creswell, by the way, because it was discovered much later. So Creswell didn't know about the existence of this building. So the church here is called the Katisma Church, and a site located between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, and is considered to be a shrine, Christian shrine, built in the 5th century in order to commemorate the figure of Mary. So it's a shrine for Mary, Christian shrine.
Catisma vuol dire più o meno sedia.
Yes.
Il luogo della Vergine, partendo da Gerusalemme e andando già super incinta a Betlemme, sta carino, ce la fa più, si siede e per commemorare questo posto
Perfect. In fact, there is a rock in the center of the building. You can see it here. Well, this rock, allegedly, of course, is the rock where Mary seated, rested for a while on her way to Bethlehem. Well, this site was abandoned later in the 11th century, apparently because the traditions attached to this site were not so strong, basically, to withstand later traditions that based the nativity to Bethlehem, of course, and other events of the life of Christ and the life of Mary in other sites in the area. So it was not very successful, this site here. But nevertheless, in the 5th century, it was very important. It was a pilgrimage site and was still existing in the Islamic, during the Islamic conquest. To the extent, by the way, that some scholars have suggested that this site was one of the models for the Dome of the Rock, so the most important religious building built by the Muslims in Jerusalem. This is another story. Well, it's part of the same story, but it's another branch. Okay, so so the water, there was water here. The water was channeled to the rock and offered as eulogia to pilgrims. Now, what is interesting, however, the excavation, of the octagonal structure carried out by Israeli Antiquities Authority is that, this slide is not, okay, is that they unearthed a niche located on the southern side of the inner corridor of the building, which is on the right-hand side. You can see it on the right plan. Stratigraphy dates the opening of the niche to the early 8th century. And you can also see that probably the apse was walled off, and more or less this happened apparently in the same period the niche was opened here. Okay? So no more apse in the building and a niche on the southern side. Now, to the same period also probably dates also this sort of triangular floor mosaic showing a central palm tree flanked by two smaller plants, a motif to be found also in the wall mosaics of the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. So now, deprived of the apse, with a new vegetal mosaic and a niche on its southern wall, the octagonal church might have been used by Muslims as a place of worship. And why? Apparently, because in the Quran, so in the holy text of Islam, there is a passage in which the nativity of Jesus is related to the place in which Mary rested and was nourished by a palm tree. Okay, so it's possible that early Muslims, with their text in their hands, let's say, well, identified this sanctuary as a sanctuary somehow also mentioned in the Quran. Well, this is a hypothesis, of course. I mean, it's not for sure, but it's interesting to notice all this evidence together. Later on, and this is also interesting because, of course, traditions move holy sites around Palestine very often. The nativity of Jesus, according to the Muslim narrative, was moved to Jerusalem. So nowadays, according to the dominant Muslim narrative, Jesus was born in Jerusalem. And not in Bethlehem, and not here, in the Katisma site. So it's complicated. But at the very beginning of Islam, it's possible that because of the presence of this monumental building, and because of the Christian worship and commemoration to this building, Muslims, well, they had their text in their hands and they identified, well, also in our text, this place is so important, so holy. And perhaps this was used by Muslims, and this was related to the nativity of Mary.
But why would they build a
a mosque in a place they thought it was Christian, and where they invented or hypothesized Christ was born. Just to.
Well, no. I think the point here is that basically there was this strong tradition also among Christians that, of course, Bethlehem was very important, but apart from Bethlehem, that in my opinion remained a super, very Christian city. And in fact, Bethlehem, apart from the last 20 years, because of the changes in Palestine, was always a Christian city. I mean, the most part of the population of Bethlehem was Christian. I mean, was never Islamized, Bethlehem. So Bethlehem remained really a Christian site. Well, Muslims, you know that Muslims took Jesus within their history as a very important prophet before Muhammad. Well, this is well known. All prophets before Muhammad were acknowledged and taken within Muslim narrative. But Jesus was very important, was one of the most important prophets before Muhammad, to the extent that Jesus with Mary are mentioned in the Quran. And even there is a surah, there is a chapter on them in the Quran. So they were very important. And they're also mentioned in the Dome of the Rock. One of the problems, of course, for Muslims was that Jesus was only a prophet. He was fully human. He was not the Son of God. Like Muhammad. Muhammad is a pure human being. He has nothing to do with the divine nature of God. I mean, nothing to do. They are prophets. They are humans like us, special humans perhaps, but not any relation with the divine. Despite the fact, this is a bit problematic, Quran accepts the fact, the miraculous the fact that Mary gave birth to Jesus without being touched by a man. Okay, so this is accepted by Quran, so that's sort of in between. But nevertheless, Jesus is a man. So that's the main difference, let's say. But I think I lost a bit my my train. But that's why this site was so important, probably. So Muslims arrived. They had this very important, let's say, they gave a lot of importance to Jesus, and they were looking around for sites commemorating Jesus and Mary, and they decided probably that this site was the one possible site for commemorating Jesus, and they perhaps converted this site into a mosque. Now, however, one of the problems we have now, okay, what happened to Christians here? Okay, Christians had this building, they were used to pilgrim to worship this rock because it was so important for them. What happened to them? So, recently, I mentioned to you Disegni, this scholar. Well, she reworked an inscription found on the site. Well, this inscription that you find here, and that's the article in which it's discussed, would suggest that the site was still somehow used also by Christians in the late 8th century, early 9th century. We don't know, however, how this site was used by Christians and how basically Muslims and Christians were using this site together. We don't know anything, basically. It's only a matter of speculation. So, but the important point is that this is one of the few cases in which perhaps we do have a clear, more or less clear use of a Christian building by Muslims. Okay? And perhaps the reason for such a use is this identification of the site with Mary. Okay. Sud.
Sì. E che io mi chiedo, no? Perché non c'è la nascita e c'è la perché l'orientamento è diverso? era stato anche usato da cristiani, e quindi è curioso, curioso è la parola, è interessante per capire tutto questo problema della trasformazione nel
mondo. See, exactly. And yeah, south is correct. It's correct because we are in Syria or Jordan or Palestine. And if you think of a kind of world map, of course, Mecca, it's south of this region. So basically, if a church is looking east, it's enough basically to use the side of the church looking south in order to correct orientate your prayer, okay? According to the Muslim worship. And here the small niche is located south, so another sort of hint or another piece of evidence to claim this building was used by Muslims. Okay, so now I have to move, otherwise... I hope it's clear now. Until now. Now the other side, which apparently was a church converted into a mosque, is the Basilica of Saint John. Well, we don't know exactly what was the saint dedicated to, but basically the great church of Hama in today Syria again. Here you see basically a view before the destruction of the city during the revolt which took place in the early 80s in the city under the father of the actual president of Syria. Insurgents, they were sieged and they took refuge into the mosque, and the mosque was bombed and destroyed. So this is a picture from before. That's why all the documentation made by French scholars is so important in Syria. So this is a pre-reconstruction sort of picture. And this is a plan. It's a redrawing, which appears in my book, made by a colleague, of a drawing published by Crespo. Okay. So now, here I read a couple of paragraphs. Otherwise, I perhaps lose some point. So it is likely that the mosque was the readaptation of a basilica space into a mosque. However, two aspects make difficult a full assessment of what happened on this site. The first is that most likely the site had a pre-Christian Roman phase, so that the different layers of the building are hard to retrieve. So this is a site with a lot of superimposition of layers. So it's a Roman, pagan site, and then it was a pre-early Christian, and then probably a 6th century Christian, and then early Islamic, and then medieval Islamic. I mean, it's a very complicated stratification of building. The second problem is that the several reconstructions, I said, of the buildings in the modern era. So not only in the 80s, because the building was destroyed, but also under the Ottoman period, the prayer hall of the mosque was rebuilt. So it's difficult to understand what was before. Now the prayer hall, so the prayer hall of a mosque, so this is the mosque. We have the courtyard, which is here, okay? And the prayer hall is the covered space where usually the prayer takes place. And in the case of Hama is this space here. So south is this side, and here you see the niche, sorry, of the mosque, and of course east-west is this axis. So the prayer hall includes some features, some aspects, suggesting the building was not originally built as a mosque, but rather as a church. The ratio, so la proporzione, of the longitudinal east-west and latitudinal north-south walls differs from that of other early medieval mosques. So mosques in the early period were not constructed really with this kind of proportion, with this ratio. Furthermore, the remains of the supports of the original arcades running parallel to the Qibla, so I'm talking about the naves within the building, would suggest a central nave larger than the two lateral ones. Mm? I'm talking about the original structure, not the actual structure in which the naves are equidistant. Okay? And this feature with the larger nave is common in Christian architecture, and instead is exceptional when compared to other early medieval mosques with longitudinal arcades in which supports tend to be equidistant, so to create aisles of the same width. Okay? Quindi questi due elementi ci suggeriscono che l'edificio non è stato costruito direttamente come moschea, ma era prima qualcos'altro, una chiesa, punto di domanda, e poi trasformato in moschea. The apse was probably walled off and destroyed, and a niche was open in the southern side. And so the church was converted into a mosque. Why the southern side? Because the southern side, as we said, is the Qibla direction, is the direction of prayer. Okay. So the problem, however, is when should we date this conversion? Right? Because we don't have any evidence. I mean, the building was reconstructed so many times. Originally, yes, was a church, but we don't know when, the period, the date. The presence in the courtyard of a baldachin, which is this one here, which is very typical of late Umayyad, early Abbasid mosques, and was used as a treasury chamber. So the treasury of the mosque in the early medieval period in Syria was this building here. You find it in Damascus here, and dates to the Abbasid period, and also in Hama. So the presence of this baldachin and the use of round arches in the courtyard were used by Okain to suggest a late Umayyad, early Abbasid conversion of the church, perhaps, into a mosque. Okay. So the problem is that the date of this baldachin, which was very important by then, by that time, because it was the Damascus was the capital of the Umayyad Empire, was in the Great Mosque of Damascus, the most important imperial foundation in Syria. So probably it was the model for other mosques. Well, the date of this baldachin probably is the early Abbasid period, which means in the area the late 8th century, second half of the 8th century. Hmm? And we do also have a textual reference, so a written source, saying or mentioning a renovation of the Mosque of Hama under the Abbasid Caliph al-Mahdi. So all this evidence might be used, with caution of course, to support a second half of the 8th century, late 8th century date for the conversion of the Christian Basilica into a mosque. Okay? The passage, the textual passage, mentions a renovation of the mosque that took place under al-Mahdi. And I'm tempted to understand such renovation as the enlargement of a previous smaller mosque into a larger building to the detriment of the church that once stood on the side. Now, I know it's a bit complicated, but it will be more clear when we come back to Aleppo and other cities. Okay, so now let's move back to that sentence by that quotation by Creswell, you remember? So what was the evidence Creswell used in order to give this explanation? Two options, right? And especially for the second option. So the evidence, it's only textual. So he only was using written sources. Like the one you see here on this slide. And these are texts written later, some centuries later, describing the Islamic conquest of Syria. These are texts praising, describing, commemorating the glorious Islamic conquest of Syria. And this passage, for instance, that deals with the Homs or Hims, another city located nearby, Aleppo, Hama, Damascus, same area, says, when Abu Ubaidah was through with Damascus, or after Damascus, he left Damascus, he left over it in his place Yazid ibn Abu Sufyan, And he came, Abu Ubaidah, one of the early conquerors, he came to Homs through Baalbek, another famous city nowadays in Lebanon. And he camped in front of the Rastan gate of Homs. The people of Homs capitulated, surrendered, and he guaranteed the safety of their lives, possessions, city wall, churches, and wells, so water facilities, excluding 1/4 of St. John's Church, which was to be turned into a mosque. Okay? He made it a condition on those of them who would not embrace Islam to pay haraj, tax. Okay? So you pay me, you acknowledge I'm the new master of the city, and in exchange I give you safety, possession of your properties, apart from this 1/4. Okay? Now, the passage here is from Al-Baladuri, is one of these texts created in the early medieval period. A history of the Islamic conquest written in the 9th century. There are other texts mentioning similar kind of agreements between Christians and Muslims. It's the case of a text of geography and text devoted to local history. With regard to Homs, so the same city, other texts offer different sizes for the portion of the church used by Muslims. So in other texts we find that 1/4 here, an unspecified fraction according to Ibn Hawqal, another text, 1/2 for according to Al-Muqaddasi, and also 1/2 according to Istakhr. So there is not agreement in the later text about how much of the church was used by Muslims, right? In the case of Diyarbakir, the city nowadays in Turkey, the medieval author suggests 2/3 of the church were used by Muslims. So you take the church and 2/3 were used by Muslims and 1/3 remain in the hands of Christians. In Aleppo, the pact by Al-Baladuri says 1/2 of the church was given to Muslims. So it is starting with this text that scholars developed the idea that Muslims made use of 1 portion of churches. Right? It's clear. So we arrive and we take this portion. But how did this happen exactly? As the Syrian region, now we know, is located north of Mecca, the usual explanation is that Muslims, and here you see some historians nowadays, how they do explain this transition, this conversion. The usual explanation, the usual narrative is that Muslims requisitioned and used as their place of prayer the southern nave or the southern portion of basilicas. Despite such arrangement is never explained in full detail, the hypothesis runs that in some days or hours of different than those of the Christians, early Muslims would have gathered within churches to perform their congregational prayer. And this is very problematic. I mean, the idea that 2 different communities were using the same worship space. And apparently, I mean, according to some people that have also influenced my work, this was also inspired by early modern subdivision of churches between genders, for instance, or among different Christian groups after the Reformation in Northern Europe. And following this kind of pattern, some scholars have suggested how the 2 sections, how the 2 portions of the building might have been subdivided between the 2 communities. Obviously, probably, a mihrab was created and used by Muslims in order basically to direct their prayer towards Mecca.
Mattia, e questa idea,
sì?
Questa teoria della suddivisione, quindi, si basa sempre su fonti più tarde?
Più tarde e scritte sempre. Solo fonti scritte, sì. E sempre fonti tarde.
Molto tarde, da vari secoli più tardi.
Dal nono in poi.
Immaginatevi che oggi un edificio qualsiasi fosse metà per i cristiani e metà per gli arabi, non da un punto di vista di conflitto, anche di funzionalità.
Sì, anche a livello pratico è difficile immaginare questo. Allora, il mio punto di vista è che questa spiegazione è problematica, cioè non è sufficiente a chiarire tutti i problemi, ok? And I offer here some comments. So, as mentioned before, in the absence of material evidence, the partition has been evoked and suggested only through selected passages of literary sources. However, what is striking is the lack of any reference to the partition of churches in Christian sources. So, we have many Christian sources, and no one of the sources is mentioning this partition. And this point is very relevant. Because if, as several scholars suggest, the partition was a common practice after the 7th century conquest, the absolute silence of Christian theologians and historians on the subject requires an explanation. I mean, why Christians that are very active and were writing a lot and describing what was happening in their communities and with the Islamic conquest, and they never mentioned the presence of Muslims within their places of prayer. And this is problematic, in my opinion. Because, of course, the lives of Christian communities were surely unsettled and shocked by the presence of non-Christian worshippers within their churches. So to sum up basically the problem we face in this research on today's presentation, on the one hand, we have the continuity of many churches. The churches continue to be used by Christians, including the great churches in the center of cities. Churches were granted to their communities as most cities surrendered without resistance, so with this kind of agreement between the conquerors and the conquered, and continued to be used long after the conquest. At the same time, Muslims rather quickly started to organize their worship within the very same cities and started to build new places of worship. So how can we make sense of these two phenomena? Now, let's come to a conclusion, to a sort of solution, to a conclusion of this problem. So, first of all, Resafa, a city again in Syria, a Roman garrison town that grew up very much during late antiquity, as it was transformed from a fort into a holy city by virtue of the presence of the relics of Saint Sergius. To the extent that it became an international pilgrimage site, with people coming also from, for instance, Persia. So it was really an international pilgrimage site during late antiquity. The city had an important phase also during the early Islamic conquest, as it was chosen as a temporary capital. So it was the capital of the Umayyad Caliphate for a while during the Umayyad period. And in the 8th century, so this is the view of the city, in the 8th century, a market, which is number 3, which is here. A market and a great mosque, number 2, here. Number 2, were built, erected within the city, while a huge palatial area was built outside of the city walls. So not visible in this plan. Basically, if we come back here, the area around the city walls, especially this site here, had a very huge, enormous size palatial area built by the Umayyads. So this Christian site was basically occupied by Muslims, a mosque in the center of the city, a market in order to bring trade, to bring money, to revitalize the life of the city, and a mosque, but the main sanctuary was left untouched. Now, so the German excavations of the site have shown the interaction existing between the ecclesiastical complex of St. Sergius and the Great Mosque. So the mosque was built north of the complex and provided with an access to a courtyard shared with the Christian complex. The Qibla wall of the mosque was built on a portion of the courtyard, changing the architectural aspect of the structure, but without altering its function. So basically what you see here in this image is the courtyard in between the mosque, left side, sinistra, and the church, destra, right hand side. So we are looking at this space here. Hmm? And the most important place within the complex is this small room where the relics of this important saint were located. So people were circulating within the basilica, entering this room, and then, or vice versa, exiting on the in the courtyard and then out of the complex. And at the same time, the mosque is here. This is the mihrab, this is the prayer hall, this is the courtyard. Looking south, again, you remember, east the church, south the mosque. But the mosque also had a gate, the one you see, well, you don't see it really here, but there is a sort of passage located here, opening a communication between the prayer hall and the same courtyard. So the courtyard played a sort of role of a buffer zone, a cuscinetto between the two buildings. Hmm? Very interesting site, Ar-Rusafa. Now, however, the explanation for such a choice for the location of the great mosque insisted on either the homage that early Muslims in Ar-Rusafa, including the Caliph al-Court, paid to the Christian holy place, or, so, the saint was so important to the extent that also Muslims were somehow attached to him. That's one explanation. The second is insist on the control and exploitation developed by Muslim rulers of such holy place around which festivals and special market activities were carried on. You know pretty well that markets, festivities in late antiquity, Christian world, were very often organized according to the Christian calendar that was organized according to the festivities of the saints. And this is not so. Muslims not only inherited a Christian landscape, but also inherited a Christian calendar, a Christian division of time, to the extent that we know that the Christian calendar, the Islamic calendar described in the early medieval period, included also some of the Christian festivities. They had to make room within their own calendar to some of these huge, very important festivities, Christian festivities. And again, Creswell did not know about this site. Rusafa was discovered after Creswell research. However, scholarship usually describes the site as exceptional. Well, you know, because of the saint. There is, however, one case that was available to Creswell, and that shows to what extent the choice, and we come back to Aleppo, to build congregational mosques in the proximities of existing churches was a common phenomenon in early Islam. The already mentioned Aleppo, northern Syria, was a city characterized at the time of the conquest by several churches, as I told you, including the upset tetraconch built down the citadel in the center of the walled area, perhaps on the site of the former agora of the Hellenistic city. So we are talking about, you remember, well, I don't have it. Yes, here, sorry. Try to concentrate only. I'm talking about this site here. This is the church that was here. You remember the early on I show you the plan of the church with the land beside. I have shown the map of late antique Aleppo, and one of the medieval city earlier on. That would be the medieval site of Aleppo. So now, if you enter building A, this medieval madrasa, you remember 1124 is the date of foundation of this medieval building. If you enter, well, who knows nowadays what is the state of this building, but if you entered this building, well, you have the feeling to be within a Christian, late antique kind of architecture. The western side of the building still displays the semicircular arrangement of one of the conches of the former church, of the late antique church, while other late antique spolia are scattered throughout the site and rearranged in the nearby mosque and around. And here I show you two examples. Worthy of attention of mention are the wind-blown capitals stopping the columns, a fine example of a typology quite widespread in 5th, 6th century Syria. Now, so building A was clearly the church that was there in late antiquity. However, now, and since 1124, is a medieval Islamic building. Now, we are lucky, sorry, one more slide. We are lucky to have this material evidence, which is quite clear, but also textual evidence that collide, come together. They are coherent. They offer a coherent picture. Now, according to written sources, the church built around the tetraconch, which remains are now in the madrasa, which is called Madrasa al-Halawiya, was used as a church until 1124. When during a crusader siege of the city, 1124 is the moment in which the Latins are basically back or arrive in the area, during a siege of the city and as a retaliation, so una vendetta, for the desecration of a Muslim shrine extramuros outside of the city walls, the Muslim religious authority of Aleppo decided to take over 4 churches among those within the walls, intramuros, and convert them into mosques, including the Great Church of Aleppo. So in 1124, we are told by sources, contemporary sources, well, because Latin Christians are desecrating our shrines outside of the city, well, we basically take a revenge on the poor local Christians, by the way, because the 2 Christians were different, in the city, and we definitely Islamize the center of Aleppo, and we convert also this last church into a mosque. 1124, however. Until 1124, the mosque was a few decades later, under the rule of Nur ad-Din, converted into a madrasa. That's why we know it as a madrasa. Completing the Islamization of the city and pairing the great mosque of Aleppo with a place for religious teaching. You know, the madrasa is the place in which the theological teaching and learning of Islamic law, Islamic studies, was done and carried out during the medieval period. But however, until 1124, the church remained in use, and since 715, early 8th century, however, a portion of its property was used by Muslims in order to have their great mosque erected in the center of the city. Sources are very, very careful, very precise, the sources describe this situation, and describe also the use of the church as a church during the early medieval period, and they also say the area was used as a garden, as a graveyard. And there is also a recovered inscription that mentions the presence of a bathhouse within the complex. So the mosque was built with an axis perpendicular to the church. You see it here, the great mosque built in this area, which pertained to the complex of the church, but was not the church itself. Okay? Just the main point of everything, I would say. Even later, enlargement of the mosque were carried out at the expenses of the nearby marketplace and not of the nearby church. You know that very often in Islamic cities, because of the growing of the Muslim population, conversions increased, Muslim population was larger and larger, the mosque was not large enough to gather everyone, and so the mosque was enlarged. Okay? And here in Aleppo too, it happened, but the mosque was enlarged in this direction. They didn't expand the mosque in this direction, because here there was a church, and the church belonged to the Christian community. So, such an arrangement, that the one you see here in this plan, the plan that was missing in EcoCard reconstruction of the history of the city, the early medieval phase of Aleppo, between the church and the mosque, lasted for around 4 centuries. Now, in the 11th century, well, this is an image from the citadel. In the 11th century, a squared minaret was built in the northwestern corner of the enclosure of the mosque, towering the nearby church. And this is the minaret you see in this light here. And this is sadly one of the victims of the war in Syria, because you don't have to forget that apart from pre-Islamic antiquities that were destroyed, looted, robbed during the civil war in Syria, among the victims, well, I would say most part of the victims are Islamic era antiquities. So Islamic buildings are also the victims of what happened in Syria. And the minaret was basically destroyed in 2013, so it's no longer there. However, it was built in that corner during the 11th century when the church was still there, but nevertheless you can imagine that the building of such a huge tower on top of the church was a sort of a kind of invasion of the space also of Christians. So this is to say, this is an important point, the direction of mosques nearby churches was not the result of a peaceful or tolerant, we don't have to imagine a golden age of toleration, of tolerance between Christians and Muslims. I mean, we don't have to make it bigger than what it was. So was not the result of a peaceful and tolerant rule over minorities implemented by Muslim rulers, but the outcome of a long negotiation among property rights of different communities. So space was negotiated, and according to the negotiation then was taken over by one community or another. Now there is also one passage which I think it's important. Well, this is another image. Yeah, this is an image, a better image of the minaret that is no longer standing on the site and which disappeared. Now I want to conclude because perhaps you have some questions, and I need to finish because then I also need to take a train. Well, I would like to show you this passage, but it's not so important. Another case, so the last case, which shows that this Rusafa, Aleppo, Amman, in order to show that this pattern was implemented in several cities. Another city in which probably this kind of arrangement was implemented was Amman, in today Jordan. In Amman, this is a plan of the Roman Umayyad, so basically the early medieval city of Amman, with the citadel, the downtown area. Well, in the downtown area, there was a site which was called by archaeologists as the cathedral site. We don't know exactly. Probably consisting of at least two parallel churches, a common phenomenon in the Mediterranean area. Well, so these were the two churches, which, however, were not oriented towards east, but rather were following the orientation of the main road. So were dictated by the road and by the layout of the city rather than by the prayer orientation. Well, in the early 8th century, a mosque was built nearby once again. This is the mosque A. Following, however, the correct orientation for Muslim prayer, so south, more or less south. And so the two buildings, the two basically complexes, were far just a few meters, one from the other. What is also interesting, and I conclude here, is that it's clear from the remains that the mosque was built with a technique, building technique, very close to the late antique building technique, to the extent that in the early 20th century, the remains of the early mosque were interpreted as the remains of a church. And when it was time to build a new mosque for the early modern kingdom of Jordan, well, they decided to destroy the remains of the mosque, because they thought it was the remains of a church, and they built a new building on top of it. That's a very interesting story on the similarities between buildings in the late antique and early medieval period, and about the difficulty to interpret things on the ground in the early 20th century, because of course a building as such was to be interpreted as a church and not as a mosque, and therefore perhaps not useful in the construction of a new identity for the Muslim royal kingdom of Jordan in the 20th century. But again, these two buildings were, for the early, in, at least in the early medieval period, close one to each other. That's why I use the word, and that's the final point, I use the word contiguity between churches and mosques. And I think when a church is mentioned in the Arabic sources, it's not the basilica that we have to keep in mind, but we have to keep in mind that the church in late antiquity was a complex of buildings. And only one portion of this complex was used for Muslim needs. Okay, I stop here. Perhaps you have some questions.
Molto bene.
Io faccio una domanda prima che mi sembra che potrebbe essere clarificatoria per tutti. Boh, a me il tema interessa un sacco. E vedrete la prossima settimana quanto importante è questa lezione, non solo per capire cosa succede con le moschee, ma anzi per capire ancora meglio le chiese cristiane, perché le fonti islamiche per chi studia le chiese sono completamente ignote. Cioè io tanto non leggo l'arabo e non mi metterò a studiare l'arabo per le chiese, però danno dei dati fondamentali per capire poi le chiese.
Quello che voglio chiederti, per chiarificare un po', cioè il problema di queste fonti più tardi, che dicono che le chiese si dividevano, ma noi sappiamo che questa cosa è molto difficile, che le chiese si dividessero da un punto di vista pratico.
Sì.
Il problema non è tanto che le fonti siano tarde, diciamo, è che l'uso della parola chiesa non sta implicando solo l'edificio ecclesiastico, non solo la basilica, tenendo basilica anche edifici circolari, ma il complesso di edifici che facevano parte della chiesa. Noi vedremo la settimana prossima come le chiese, soprattutto quelle monastiche, quelle suburbane e soprattutto quelle cattedrali, non è solo una chiesa, non troviamo mai una chiesa. Quando noi abbiamo scavato il Duomo, mica abbiamo trovato la chiesa, abbiamo trovato tutta una serie di annessi che funzionavano insieme alla chiesa.
Esatto.
Quindi cosa facevano gli islamici? Cioè, quando costruivano una moschea, non è che stavano dividendo la chiesa, stavano dividendo la proprietà della chiesa.
Bene.
E insisto, questo ci aiuta anche a capire meglio. E così?
Sì.
Cioè, questa è la
perfetto, esattamente questo. Cioè, noi abbiamo... Intanto ci sono molti problemi nelle fonti arabe perché diversi termini sono utilizzati per definire la chiesa. C'è un termine, il più noto è canisa, che è ecclesia, dovrebbe essere esattamente la traduzione di ecclesia in arabo, canisa, e un altro termine è bia, che sarebbe però forse più altare, quindi già è un problema capire ogni volta che cosa si dice esattamente. In più però il problema è che quando si dice abbiamo preso due terzi della chiesa di Diyarbakir per farne una moschea, bene, gli studiosi hanno detto bene, hanno preso la chiesa, la basilica, e hanno preso due navate su tre per i musulmani e una navata hanno lasciata ai cristiani. E quello che dico io invece è, ma andiamo a vedere che cosa intendevano per canisa, per chiesa, le fonti arabe, e in generale cosa si intendeva per chiesa in una disputa, negoziazione sui diritti di proprietà al momento in cui le comunità cristiane si arrendono all'avanzata musulmana. L'idea è che è una perfettamente, e non è così facile spiegarlo così bene come ha fatto la professoressa, davvero, molti colleghi non ci hanno messo così poco per capire di cosa parlavo.
E io avevo letto il libro prima.
Aveva letto il libro? No, ma no, è importante perché la professoressa e voi venite dalla prospettiva in cui questo discorso è molto chiaro. Per chiesa non si può intendere una basilica, Considerate che chi viene dall'arte islamica per moschea considera la moschea con il cortile, quello è. E quindi pensava, e pensa ancora in molti casi, chiesa è un edificio, magari c'è un cortile ma è un edificio. Invece dal tardo antico si capisce che per chiesa si intende, si intendeva il complesso, la proprietà, il terreno. Qui, naturalmente è una ricostruzione, però qui l'idea è che in questa parte della città di Aleppo nel periodo tardo antico, bizantino, preislamico, ci fosse questa enorme tetraconco, absidato, che era la chiesa principale, e poi una serie di strutture, forse un'area funeraria, un giardino, non sappiamo, un bagno probabilmente, e altre strutture che facevano parte della proprietà della chiesa. I musulmani arrivano e dicono: bene, tieniti la chiesa, la basilica, ma noi prendiamo una parte, quella non sacra, quella che è meno importante, adesso non posso entrare nei dettagli perché non si sanno, ma una parte la prendiamo noi. Ed ecco che da qui arriviamo allo schema. Ho sbagliato a non mettere le vicine, le metterò la prossima volta. Lo schema, questo qui, ok? In cui abbiamo la chiesa, ebbene, è ridotta in proprietà. Naturalmente dobbiamo capire che per i cristiani comunque è un problematico il fatto di non avere più quelle strutture, non avere più quelle risorse finanziarie, avere sempre meno fedeli, avere meno possibilità di restaurare le chiese. Cioè, non sto dipingendo un'epoca d'oro in cui le comunità stavano bene insieme pacificamente, come, non so, nelle democrazie moderne vorremmo in qualche modo che fosse, però questa probabilmente è la situazione più vicina alla realtà. Cioè, la moschea viene costruita e la chiesa continua a essere utilizzata. Abbiamo fonti che descrivono processioni pasquali alla chiesa, dicendo che le processioni pasquali passano nella strada tra la porta della moschea e la chiesa. La porta occidentale della moschea è quella che è qui, e c'è ancora. Okay? Quindi ecco, passavano questo, in questa stradina, quindi proprio fanno visualizzare questo coesistenza di luoghi di culto.
Sì, e questo ci porta, che è quello che a me interessa anche sottolineare, di nuovo a quello che vi ho insistito tante volte. Se noi studiamo l'edificio della villa o studiamo il singolo forno inserito all'interno della città, questo a noi, sì, siamo archeologi, dobbiamo studiare il registro materiale, ma non ci serve a nulla se non pensiamo più dall'alto, no? Come se lo guardassimo tutto dall'alto. Questo, in rapporto a che si trova, è una proprietà pubblica, è una proprietà privata. Il mondo si muove e si è mosso sempre per questioni economiche, di proprietà, di tasse, di economia. E quindi è solo cercando, con una formazione multidisciplinare che comprenda la storia, che comprenda aspetti di proprietà, che comprenda aspetti di archeologia più materiali, che riusciremo a interpretare le cose. Se no, rimarremo sempre l'archeologo del coccio. Ecco, sì, sappiamo sto coccio di che epoca esattamente è, ma non potremo mai farne una interpretazione storica. E io credo che l'archeologo non è chi studia le fonti materiali, è chi fa storia anche a partire dei resti materiali, ma senza dimenticare il resto. C'è qualcuno che abbia qualche domanda specifica?
Prego.
Dimmi.
Ma quindi la proprietà di cui parla lei, della chiesa,
sì,
era in pratica poteva essere dei monasteri, di cui è proprio proprietà terriere.
La proprietà si riferisce a il duomo, ad esempio oggi il duomo, quando tu parli di il duomo, la proprietà del duomo è non solo il duomo è il battistero, il chiostro, quell'edificio là, quelle quattro case. In genere in questi casi sono concentrati, si concentrano in un'area specifica dove vivono i canonici, il vescovo, la signora della polizia, i magazzini, eccetera. In antico, questo lo vedremo la settimana prossima, i complessi, le proprietà erano molto più ampie e la chiesa diventa probabilmente il maggior proprietario dell'impero, sia come proprietà rurali sia come proprietà all'interno della città, come gli imperatori avevano delle proprietà, come gli edifici pubblici erano proprietà dell'imperatore, eccetera. Quello che dobbiamo comprendere è come queste proprietà si trasformano nel tempo e come vanno cambiando funzione dipendendo di chi era il proprietario,
certo,
di questo.
Esatto.
No? Quando arrivano i visigoti in Spagna, come la proprietà imperiale passa a loro mani, o quando arrivano gli islamici, questo si può fare molto bene il rapporto.
Sì, questo sarebbe un tema da fare in senso comparativo.
Tra occupanti e che cosa succede nel posto dove arrivano, no? E che cosa fanno
insieme.
Sì.
Riguardo a quello che diceva prima della chiesa e della moschea, che non è il condiviso.
Sì.
Non ho capito in che senso c'era questa condivisione.
Sì. Beh, allora, naturalmente noi non abbiamo una descrizione di un giorno di pellegrinaggio al sito di San Sergio a Rosafa, purtroppo, e quindi non abbiamo una descrizione magari vivida che ci racconta perché questo sito fu abbandonato in epoca medievale e quindi non più utilizzato in epoca moderna, eccetera, eccetera. Però da quello che è il ritrovamento archeologico, la ricostruzione, quello che ha stupito, perché questo è il primo caso che è emerso a livello archeologico, è come la moschea venne costruita, è questa la moschea, utilizzando una piccola porzione di un cortile che era attaccato alla basilica o la parte principale del complesso di San Sergio, e che la moschea, di cui qui vediamo il muro della Qibla dall'esterno, cioè noi siamo la foto è presa da qui, c'è la freccia praticamente, da qui c'è questa foto, quindi noi stiamo guardando questo muro da questo punto. Bene, sia la moschea che la chiesa hanno accesso a questo cortile, e entrambe poi hanno accesso all'esterno. Quindi un'ipotesi è che ci fosse una circolazione di persone attraverso cortile, in relazione naturalmente alla presenza delle reliquie di San Sergio che erano in questa stanza, e in relazione sia alla moschea in questo lato che alla chiesa dall'altro lato. Ora noi, se la domanda è, sappiamo se i musulmani venerassero anche loro direttamente San Sergio? No, non lo sappiamo, cioè sappiamo che alcuni santi vengono menzionati dai musulmani come persone molto pie, persone che guariscono, quindi venivano in qualche modo visitati anche dai musulmani, però ecco, non abbiamo esattamente la prova finale che San Sergio fosse santo anche per i musulmani. Questo...
Non c'è nemmeno bisogno.
Però non c'è bisogno. Però non c'è bisogno in questo caso davvero l'architettura parla abbastanza chiaramente. Non presero possesso della chiesa, anzi, in qualche modo porsero omaggio alla chiesa, costruendo su questo lato la loro moschea, sì, e lasciando intatta la moschea.
La settimana prossima, quando parleremo di questo, soprattutto nei complessi suburbani, oggi è Santa Giustina, ad esempio, ma tutto quello che erano i complessi suburbani di Roma, di qualsiasi città, il fatto che ci fossero le reliquie di un martire creava tutta una serie di cose che chiamano monasteri, e dopo si convertono in monasteri, e si chiamavano monasteri in quell'epoca, ma erano alcuni popoli funzionali, si vendevano cianfrusaglie, si vendeva cibo, si tenevano i malati che andavano a pregare, cioè c'era un'attività in qualche modo santa, ma anche in qualche modo, insisto, economica, sociale, eccetera, che probabilmente le persone che di cultura islamica o di religione islamica utilizzavano anche, magari vendevano anche loro qualcosa o andavano a comprare, cioè diventano punti di socializzazione e punti di sviluppo economico. Quindi per quello è tanto interessante che chiesa e moschea condividono uno spazio, diciamo, sociale all'interno, e non viene scandalizzare a Roma, San Pietro, al dintorno, cioè viene famiglie, cioè basta andare a Sant'Antonio, è Sant'Antonio, cioè c'è un negozio lì economico, e magari oggi ci sono dei pacchi che vendono anche delle collarine, eccetera. Sono cristiani? No, però usano quello spazio sociale per fare negozio, come fanno i cristiani.
Prego.
Per quanto riguarda il conflitto che c'è attualmente in Siria, cioè la ricerca, quanto subisce questo conflitto?
Zero patatero, voi che
avete? Tutti gli edifici distrutti nel futuro per analizzare il territorio della Siria.
Certo, no, è un problema. Beh, insomma, ancora no, è un problema enorme, sono vari problemi, dunque è stato evidenziato come per esempio i musei sono stati molto ben protetti, la maggior parte dei musei, cioè sono riusciti ad operare strategie per salvaguardare gran parte dei musei, non tutti. Per esempio quello di Apamea, una famosa città siriana di epoca romana, purtroppo il museo è stato devastato, è stato anche derubato prima che si potesse intervenire praticamente. Quindi i musei però in via generale sono stati molto ben protetti. I siti archeologici purtroppo no, e vabbè, il caso di Palmira forse è più noto. Palmira ha subito danni notevoli. Il caso di Aleppo e degli edifici musulmani sono meno noti perché magari sono meno sui media, però altrettanto vero è che la città di Aleppo per esempio ha perso gran parte del souk ottomano, che era uno dei souk più estesi della zona e uno dei più antichi forse anche, e più naturalmente edifici religiosi come la moschea o come probabilmente anche la madrasa ex chiesa che stava di fianco. Io fino a 2 o 3 anni fa era ancora lì, adesso però davvero non lo so, è possibile che siano stati distrutti in gran parte. Ancora bisogna finire di fare una sorta di database. Era molto attivo il dipartimento delle antichità, delle antichità siriane, era molto attivo sul territorio, però poi alcune zone erano fuori, non erano tenute.
Sì, però non bisogna scandalizzarsi, perché durante la seconda guerra mondiale, cioè 50 anni fa, tedeschi, francesi, inglesi, eccetera, hanno fatto esattamente lo stesso in Europa. Cioè è una delle conseguenze.
Sì, sì. Mm-hmm. Beh, Cassino, per esempio, se uno pensa a Cassino, si è distrutto. L'importante è avere documentazione, e purtroppo, però questo si può dire, non tutto era stato documentato, e in più ci sono gli scavi illegali, che sono un grosso problema, gli scavi illegali.
Noi lo sentiamo molto questo, lo sanno molta gente che è qui, e praticamente avevamo organizzato una gita per andare in Siria, avevamo portato i maggiori specialisti della Siria per farci un corso, dopo dovevamo andare una trentina di persone di Padova in Siria, e il giorno che stavamo per partire ci hanno chiamato all'agenzia della Farnesina, hanno detto non partite. Cioè, e quindi non abbiamo più visto niente, tutto questo l'avrei visto, non l'ho mai visto, no? Però vabbè, pazienza, ci portiamo gente che ce lo spiega. Ecco, lo lasciamo andare perché deve prendere.
Sì, no, l'ultima cosa che posso dire è che davvero questo primo periodo islamico dovesse essere studiato per la Siria, per la Giordania, per il Nord Africa, per la Spagna, davvero necessita di persone che sono formate in studi di tardo antichistica, diciamo. E che poi magari prendono, e non è difficile, vi assicuro, insieme al greco, o invece che il greco, dei corsi di lingua araba, che è difficile uguale, anzi forse meno difficile, per poter poi magari leggere le fonti e non essere accusati di essere tardo-antichisti che invadono il campo di studio che non è loro perché non sanno la lingua. Allora, non è impossibile creare un profilo di studioso, questo voglio dire, che in qualche modo conosca molto bene i materiali, ed è molto meglio, come vi ho detto all'inizio, approcciare da un punto di vista tardo antico, il primo Islam, e conoscano le fonti attraverso qualche corso di lingua araba. Non è una, l'arabo non è un, davvero, è molto, la grammatica è molto più facile di quella del greca, davvero. Quindi uno potrebbe mescolare le due
discipline formazione.
Di formazione, sperando che intanto poi il mondo accademico evolva.
Ecco, tutti
per non rimanere schiacciato dalla
ecco, grazie mille. Bene. Niente, ci vediamo mercoledì.